A couple of weeks ago, I published a video where I launched a number of criticisms against the OWASP Top 10. That the name didn't really make any sense, that the way it was compiled didn't result in an accurate list of the most critical risks, etc. I received a lot of great responses to the video, and many people agreed with the points I was trying to raise. However, this is a follow-up video, and you've seen the title, so yeah. I was wrong about one thing I said. Kinda. In the video, I said that the list wasn't ordered by criticality, and was instead ordered by frequency of sorts. This was based on the research I did for the video, but a follower going by the name of Palk or Palk on X linked me to an article explaining how the ordering of the list was determined. As it turns out, the list is ordered by criticality, but why is cryptographic failures so high? The more I read about how the order is determined, the more questions I had. Before we get into that, and if you're still here, hello, I'm Tiberius. I've been a web app pen tester for over a decade, and I'd really appreciate it if you gave this video a like, subscribed to the channel, and left a comment sharing your thoughts. Okay, enough about me, and more about why I was wrong. So, if you remember, the initial data collection process uses statistics submitted by various vendors, including pen testing companies, vulnerability scanning companies, and bug bounty platforms. As I stated in the previous video, none of this data has anything that can be used to calculate the risk posed. In fact, at a bare minimum, the data submitted just needs to include the number of applications tested and the CWEs with the number of applications they were found in. It's important to reiterate that CWEs do not have risk data. They are common weakness enumerations, effectively a taxonomy of different weaknesses and their relationships. For example, CWE79 is improper neutralization of input during web page generation, cross-site scripting, which is a child of CWE74, improper neutralization of special elements in output used by a downstream component, injection. CWE79, the cross-site scripting one, has children of its own, covering a few variants of XSS. None of these CWEs have risk data attached because risk cannot be determined from a generic description of a security weakness. It depends upon the context in which that weakness was found. It is possible to have a general idea of how risky a vulnerability might be on average, but there may be a large range of risk that needs consideration. For example, SQL injection is, on average, a high if not critical security risk to applications. However, it's possible for SQL injection to be medium or potentially low risk. If the application isn't public, if it requires a privileged account to access, and if the data accessible via the SQL injection is not confidential, you may end up with a CVSS score of 2.4. Now, before someone points out in the comments that CVSS is not a measure of risk, and that NIST even literally says that in bold on their website, I think that just opens up a larger conversation about what is risk anyway. This isn't the video for that. I gave a simplistic definition in the previous video, where risk was roughly equal to severity multiplied by likelihood of exploitation. CVSS scores have metrics that measure severity and exploitability, both things I think can calculate a rough risk score. OWASP and I appear to agree on this point at least, because they also use CVSS scores to calculate risks for the top 10. But remember, CVSS scores aren't part of the initial data collection process. So where does OWASP get the risk data for the OWASP top 10? CVEs. Yup. They used CVSS scores from CVEs. To be specific, they downloaded OWASP dependency check and extracted the CVSS exploit and impact scores grouped by related CWEs, then calculated the average CVSS scores for the CWEs in each of the OWASP top 10 categories and used those averages to create an ordering. If that doesn't immediately start ringing alarm bells in your head, let me try and explain the reasons why this is a really bad idea. Firstly, as I've explained a number of times on my streams, CVEs can only be issued for publicly available software. That is, software you can somehow acquire and install yourself. If you find an SQL injection on, say, paypal.com, you cannot get a CVE for it because paypal.com is not installable software. However, if you were to find an SQL injection in a WordPress blog, and the injection was traced back to either WordPress core code or some WordPress plugin, you could get a CVE for that specific component. This is important to know because the first issue I have with using CVEs to calculate the risk is the data isn't the same. OWASP are using risk data from publicly available software to determine the risk posed to applications which may not be publicly available at all. In fact, I'd wager the vast majority of the data submitted to the OWASP Top 10 comes from largely non-installable applications, given that the data often comes from places like pen test companies and bug bounty platforms. Is it possible that the risks facing publicly available software largely match the risks facing other software? Sure, it's possible, but if you're trying to do data-based analysis, you shouldn't be making those kind of assumptions, and you certainly shouldn't be mixing two separate data sources if you can avoid it. If OWASP want accurate risk data, they should ask for it from the same vendors who are providing the vulnerability data in the first place. They're already asking for a list of CWEs found. Is it really that difficult to ask for the average CVSS score alongside each CWE? But hey, like I said, maybe the risks facing publicly available software match the risks facing other software. Except they don't, at least not in the way the CVE system tracks them. Ask any web app pen tester what the average CVSS rating in their reports is, and I guarantee they will say low or medium. Finding low severity stuff on a pen test is easy, and the low and medium severity findings are almost always low risk. Even if you do have high or critical findings, the sheer number of lows and mediums is going to bring the average down. Now let's look at the average CVSS rating for CVEs. There are a few CVE tracking sites out there, but CVEDetails.com has a page which displays the distribution of vulnerabilities by CVSS scores, which also includes the weighted average CVSS score, 7.5. Remember, anything between 7.0 and 8.9 is considered high. Now, granted, these numbers are for all CVEs tracked by CVEDetails.com, but even if you grab the numbers for the past 4 years of CVEs, you still get an average above 7.0. The reason for this is kinda obvious from the actual distribution graph. Where are all the low severity CVEs? Incidentally, I'm 99% sure this 0 to 1 number is almost all CVEs without an actual CVSS score, because using the search functionality, I could only find 8 CVEs with a score between 0.1 and 1.0 inclusive. Those CVEs without a score are likely still waiting for one to be assigned, so I'm not sure if they're included in the weighted average or not. Either way, there are hardly any CVEs with a score under 2, and only 3,500 with a score between 2 and 4. This is due to a few things, the biggest reason likely being the fact that not many people apply for low severity CVEs. Not every vulnerability becomes a CVE, and if a vendor doesn't apply for one automatically, it's up to the researcher who found the vulnerability to register one. For many people, it's just not worth the time, especially if it's ultimately a low or medium severity issue. In addition to this, some vendors are CVE numbering authorities, CNAs, themselves, meaning they are the only party that can issue a CVE for a specific program. These CNAs may impose their own limitations on what qualifies for a CVE. For example, Android is a CNA, and they state that a CVE may not be issued for issues assessed as low or NSI, negligible security impact. Another thing worth mentioning in regard to low and medium issues in general is, at least for web app testing, they include a bunch of misconfigurations that generally don't make for good CVEs. Take the example of a misconfigured content security policy header, which potentially opens up the application to some form of cross-site scripting, but ultimately can't be shown to do this during a test. I still report this because fixing it involves a simple change to the CSP that increases the overall security posture of the application, but it doesn't really make sense as a CVE. CSPs are contained within HTTP response headers and often set as part of the web server configuration rather than by the application, though they can be, of course. It's not necessarily an application vulnerability, even though it affects the application. This is also true for a lot of TLS and SSL issues too. My overall point here is the average CVSS score for CVEs is skewed towards the higher end of the range for various reasons, and this is going to have an effect if you use CVSS data from CVEs to rank data that isn't subject to the same limitations as the CVE system. This is especially going to be the case for categories that contain a lot of vulnerabilities that would normally be low or medium severity. If those aren't recorded in the CVE system, the average CVSS score is going to be inflated more than it would be for categories that contain a lot of high or critical severity vulnerabilities. This, I think, is what actually explains the weird ordering of the OWASP top 10. So, correction issued. The list is technically sorted by criticality, but my main points from the original videos still stand, and I think the data collection process is even more broken than I originally thought it was. I previously said that these issues could be fixed by collecting CVSS data, and it appears that they were collecting it, just not data that made sense. So, in a weird kind of double irony, I was wrong about saying they didn't collect CVSS data, but my recommendation that they collect CVSS data is actually still valid. It should just be collected alongside the vulnerability statistics, not sourced from CVEs. That, I feel, would go a long way to creating a top 10 that more accurately reflects the current security landscape of web applications. Thank you so much for watching. If anything, I think we've learned more about the OWASP top 10 process. If you enjoyed the video, please give it a like, subscribe to the channel, leave a comment, hey, and help me out by sharing the video on social media if you use it. I'm trying to get to 20,000 subscribers here on YouTube and create regular content for the channel, so it would be appreciated. I'll see you next time.